Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Squirrel Pie Productions podcast, my podcast about knitting, spinning, and sewing. My name is Tommi, and you can find me on Ravelry as DynamiteTrujillo and on Instagram as Squirrel Pie Productions. Welcome to episode 16. I am so happy you're joining me today. Welcome to any new viewers. Thank you for checking out my podcast, and a big welcome back to anybody who is a returning viewer. I really appreciate you coming back week after week to check out my podcast. So today is a really nice sunny Friday on the Northern California coast where I am coming to you from. And I am enjoying some tea out of my big giant teacup that is way too big for any reasonable person. It's got an octopus on it. And today I am drinking some Yogi Egyptian licorice tea, which is tea that I really, really, really love. And you might remember it was popularized quite a while ago by Kristen of the Yarngasm podcast, who used to drink it sometimes on her podcast. And then I feel like it kind of gained a lot of popularity among us online knitters. And for good reason, it's super delicious. So cheers. This is a teacup that requires two hands to use. Like, seriously. I'm putting it down now. Okay, it's fine. Anyway, we have a Ravelry group that you should totally go join. It's under Squirrel Pie Productions in Ravelry. There's also a link in the title bar of my podcast channel, Squirrel Pie Productions. And that is where you'll find the show notes to this episode and all previous episodes. It's also where you'll find knit along news, giveaway news, an ask me anything thread, an FO thread that you should post your FOs in if you would like to share them with the group. And there's also an introductions thread. So if you have not introduced yourself yet to the rest of the group, please do so there. It's really fun to read everybody's hellos and stories. So check out the Ravelry group. It's awesome over there. I love it. And I do have a new make-along that I would like to announce. This is starting today and running through June 1st. I'm going to be doing the mini scrap-along. And this is a make-along for any kind of craft where you start out with something mini or a scrap of your material. So, mini skeins. Scrap yarn, fat quarters, little teeny bumps of fiber, rolags, anything like that, use them. You don't have to finish anything. I just want to see everybody using them. I love working with scrap yarn and mini skeins and little teeny bumps of fiber. And I want to see everybody else using them too and joining along with me. So we're going to do this make along about a month and a half. Just use all that stuff that you have on hand and post about it in the Ravelry group. I'm going to start a chatter thread, and there is going to be no FO thread because I'm not requiring you to finish anything for this make along. I just want you to join in, and there will be prizes, which I have not gotten together yet, but I'll show them as I do. And if you are a shop owner and would like to donate prizes for this make along, I would love that. So contact me if you're interested in doing that. And I'm going to be pulling winners from the Ravelry group, from the Ravelry thread for this make-along, and from Instagram. So use the hashtag mini scrap-along, and I'll pull winners from Instagram as well. And there's not really any rules to this make-along. I just want to see people using their scraps, either yarn, fabric, fiber, whatever, using their minis, using their fat quarters, using all those little tiny things in bigger projects. So get going on that. Rummage through your mini bin. Pick up your cozy memories blanket again. Pick up your crochet blanket again. Anything, you know, if you feel like it's a scrap or a mini something, use it and you qualify. So just share your progress in the thread, share your progress on Instagram. I want to see what you're doing. Get your drop spindle out. That's what I'm doing. I'm super inspired lately, mostly by Casey of the Creative Musings podcast, to pick up my drop spindle again. And I have been loving it. I'll show you a little bit of that later. So that's my big thing for this make along right now, is using up all these little mini. I'll show you later. So that's that. New make along. I hope you're excited. I'm excited. I am going to be drawing for prizes the day after my birthday. I'm gonna bring up my birthday every chance I get because I love talking about it. Anyway, through June 1st, get going. Okay, anyway, is that it? I think that's it for that kind of stuff. I'm gonna show you my first finished object because it's what I'm wearing. It's my Rosalind tunic. This is a pattern by Veronica Avery. It's a Brooklyn tweed pattern. I finished this last week. It is done and blocked and wearable, and I'm super excited. The yarn that I used for this tunic is Jill Draper Makes Stuff in the Hudson Base. This is the Pacific colorway. I had 4 skeins and I hardly broke into my 3rd skein. So I used just over 2 skeins for this project. So I have a lot of leftover. Maybe I'll do something for the mini scrap along with the leftovers. So let me get up and try to show you this thing. It's a tunic, so it's pretty long, and I am mostly really happy with it. So it's got 3/4 sleeves, which is a modification. I modified this pattern quite a lot. I'm really short, so I'm trying to show you the bottom. Standing on my toes. Anyway, here it is. It comes down to right about here. And it's got a 2x2 hem on the bottom. It was a bottom-up tunic. I did shorten the length of it quite a bit because I'm really short. I am, I'm 5 feet tall, kind of. 5 feet or 5 feet one. The Yarngasm podcast this week made me laugh because she said she's between 2 heights depending on how she's feeling that day. I'm either 5 feet or 5 feet one, depending on how I'm feeling that day. And so I did shorten this quite a bit. I'm really, really happy with the length. I'm really happy with the sleeves. The pattern called for short sleeves, and I made them 3/4 length sleeves. And I did a little bit of math to figure out a different cast-on stitch count because I needed to make them smaller because it's going down to a smaller part of my arm. And that worked out really well. I'm really happy with how the sleeves came out. Another modification that I did was the neckline. This pattern calls for a turtleneck, and I didn't want a turtleneck, so I just did 2x2 ribbing. And that modification was pretty simple. I won't go too much into what I did, because if you don't have the pattern, it might not make that much sense. So what I'm gonna do is put detailed notes in the project page for this project on Ravelry. If you're interested in knowing more about how I did this, check over there. But pretty much I did short rows instead of what the pattern called for. And I just did the 2x2 ribbing for a few rounds. I did a tubular cast on for the hem and the sleeve cuffs, and I did a tubular bind off for the neckline. And construction wise, this pattern was really simple, really fun, really straightforward and basic. So that was nice. I am really happy with how the sleeves came out. I love raglan shoulders. There are a couple of things there's like one thing that I kind of don't like about it, maybe 2 things. I do wish I would have gone down a needle size. My gauge was right on point in my swatch, but I wish the fabric was a little tighter. It's very loose. It's just very loose. It grew a lot when I blocked it. My swatch didn't grow a lot when I blocked it. It didn't grow at all when I blocked it. And kind of lately, the Knit Girls in their podcast have been talking about how swatches lie. And you know what? Sometimes they do. It's just a swatch, even if you do a big swatch, a swatch this big is different from an entire garment. And in this case, my swatch did not grow at all when I blocked it, but this sweater grew a lot when I blocked it. It's the fabric is just really, really loose. I feel like if I would have done one needle size smaller, I would be happier with the fabric and it would fit a little better. It's a little big. So I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but this thing grew so much when it fit pretty well right after I knit it, and it grew so much after I blocked it that I put it in the dryer. It's superwash yarn. I still don't like drying. I'd never ever dry my knitwear unless it's a situation like this where I kind of want it to shrink up a little bit. So I put it in the dryer like right after blocking, full on wet still. I didn't lay it out at all. I just threw it in the dryer with, I actually did a load of laundry so that I could have a full load to dry. And then I put it all in the dryer with this. And I checked it pretty frequently when it was going through the dry cycle to see if it was getting back to size or if it was starting to felt or, you know, just to make sure it was doing okay. And I ended up drying it to the point where it was almost completely dry. Because that was the point where it shrank back up to its original size. It didn't go any smaller than its original knit size, but I got it back to the size that it was when I knit it. And so that's a little bit of a bummer. I don't like the idea of drying it every time I wash it. Because even though it's superwash, I do wash all of my knitwear by hand and usually just lay it out to dry. So we'll see. We'll see about the wear. So it did come out a little bigger than I wanted. Also in the sense that I knit the smallest size for this, but around the waist, it's like pretty baggy. And it's supposed to have some positive ease, but I feel like, let me just show you. So it fits pretty well from the front view. But if you look right here, there's a lot of extra fabric, like right there, and it's all in the back somehow. So I think I would have benefited from a more dramatic waist decrease for the shaping. But I don't know. It's fine. It's you know, it's a little bigger, a little baggier than I would like. But hey, it still fits, it still works, it's an awesome sweater, and I love it, even though there are those two little tiny hang-ups. So that's pretty much it. I really enjoyed knitting this. I had a couple little mess-ups here and there. when I was doing, so pretty much you knit bottom-up for the body, you knit bottom-up for the sleeves, which I did two at a time, and I did not like it at first, but I ended up loving it at the end. I still don't think I'm interested in doing two at a time socks, but I feel like for sleeves from now on, I am gonna try again doing two at a time sleeves. I really liked it. And so you'd knit the sleeves bottom up and then you attach everything together and then you start the raglan decreases. I messed up a little bit on the raglan decreases. I blame the Trailer Park Boys, which is a Canadian television show that I love so much. And the new season of that came out recently, so I watched a lot of it. And I was doing the raglan decreases one night, watching that show and enjoying a glass of bourbon. And I somehow ended up with differing stitch counts for the sleeves and I fudged it and it worked out fine. But so there was that. There was also a couple issues with my tubular cast-ons. Again, with stitch counts being off, but you know what? I'm a fudger. I fixed everything as I got to it. And I really enjoyed it. It's the kind of thing where you bind off for the armholes a little bit, and then once you attach it, you end up with holes in the armpit of the sweater. And you have to go back later and seam it up. So for that, I did a horizontal mattress stitch, which is a technique I don't use that often, and I had to look it up once I decided that that's what I wanted to do, because the instructions pretty much just say, sew the armpit holes closed. So I figured out the method I wanted to use, which was the horizontal mattress stitch, looked up a really good clear video on YouTube that I will link to in the show notes, and that worked out really well. I don't mattress stitch that often because I don't often knit sweaters in pieces. I've only done that once before, and so that was pretty fun. It was just like 8 stitches or something, so I liked it. Oh, I should mention that I did use the recommended needle size called for in the pattern, which was an 8 for the body, and the ribbing I did in a couple different smaller needle sizes. You're supposed to do the ribbing, I believe, in a 6, which I did for most of it. The sleeve cuffs I accidentally did in like a 4 or something like that. So I think I would have been better off using a size 7 for the body. But again, I love it. I do really love how it turned out. It's super cozy. It's super warm. And I love a good tunic. The tunic is kind of my favorite style of top or even dress. I'll wear it as both with pants or leggings or tights or whatever. I love it. I love the tunic. I want to make more. I don't know if I'll make another knitted tunic for a while because I don't know why. But I'll probably sew some more tunics coming up pretty soon. I have a couple of tunic sewing patterns. And there's a couple more that I really like. There's actually a sew over it tunic pattern. It's the one with the pocket in the front. It's made out of jersey fabric. I love that one, but unfortunately sew over it patterns don't really run in my size. I have a 32 inch bust, and the smallest that they go in their sizes for their sewing patterns is a 33, and that's for the actual bust measurement. And then if you look at the finished garment measurement, it's always like a 34. So I feel like their patterns are all gonna end up being just too big for me. So I'm not able to use their patterns unless I try doing a small bust adjustment, which is a lot of work. I think mostly I'd rather just find patterns that have a bust measurement that would fit me to begin with. But anyway, that's my FO. I am super happy with it, and I hope to get a lot of wear out of it. The area where I live, I can wear worsted weight sweaters like all year round, so yeah. Next up, I've got my work in progress. I only have one this week. I spent a lot of time this last week working on this. And the other project, knit-wise, that I was working on is my late August shawl. This is a pattern by Sylvia McFadden. It is a pie shawl. And I am using this yarn. It is Sincere Sheep. And this is a yarn company out of Napa Valley, which is in California. And this is the Agleem base. It's 50% superwash merino, 50% tencel in the Virid colorway, which is this beautiful tonal green. This is a very shiny yarn, super shiny. And because it's so shiny, I thought it would be good in pie shawl. Right? That makes sense, doesn't it? So that's the second skein that I haven't broken into yet. Here is what's left of my first skein. I am almost done with it. And this is my project so far. It's a pie shawl, so it's knit in the round. And so it's pretty ridiculous looking right now. But here is the middle. Pretty much for a pie shawl, you cast on right in the middle, which is super dang fiddly. And then I've got this garter section here. And then this right here is the blackberry bramble lace section. That was super, super fun to knit. I just finished that section. I really, really enjoyed that lace pattern. Super easy, super short repeat, just all around the rounds. and I loved it. I just got to the point where I did my second or my next set of increases. Pretty much the way a pie shawl works, it's an old formula created by Elizabeth Zimmerman, and any pie shawl is going to do this. It's, you pretty much knit with a certain stitch count for a while, and then you do one row of super increases where you pretty much like double your stitch count in a single row, and then you knit your next set of rows with that same stitch count, and you continue doing that. So I did an increase section here. You can see it with these eyelets. And up here, I'm just working on a little bit of a garter stitch section. At that last increase round is where in the pattern you can decide if you're gonna do the modification to make it bigger or not. And I debated on that for a little while before deciding that I was gonna do it, I was gonna make it bigger. Now, that's a little iffy because I have two skeins of this yarn and that's about 840-ish yards. The pattern for the regular non-modified version calls for exactly that much yarn, pretty much. So I have as much yarn as is called for in the pattern for the unmodified version. Now, I still, given that fact, I still decided to do the modification where you can make it bigger. And I know that's super risky and probably super dumb, but whatever, I live on the edge and I feel like I'm gonna have enough yarn. It's this intuition I have. I shouldn't have enough yarn according to the numbers, but I feel like I'm gonna have enough yarn. As I mentioned in last week's podcast, a lot of times I end up using a lot less yarn than is called for in the pattern. For whatever reason, I don't know if it's me or if it's, you know, I think a lot of designers call for more yarn than they actually use in their sample, just so that people are safe, so that they have enough to begin with. So I think I'm gonna be okay. And you know what, if I'm not, if I run out of yarn, worst case scenario, I'll either do a contrasting color for the edge or I'll buy another skein of this yarn if it's still available in this color. So I'm really not too worried about it. There's a chance, probably a pretty good chance, that I'll run out of yarn, but I'll deal with it when I get there. That's for future Tommi to worry about. So I have got my, look at this. See, I got stuff like that happening in my projects like all the time. This little thing here. And that's because whenever I knit, my cat likes to jump on my lap so that I can't knit. And then she'll claw at my project. I let her do it. So this thing's getting pretty dang big. And I really, really like it. I can't wait until I get further on it. There's another lace section coming up after this sort of section where you modify it and make it bigger. I think I'm gonna be doing garter for a little while and then I'll do another lace panel and then there's this really beautiful edging. And like I'm really not worried about running out of yarn. I feel like I'm gonna have enough. So that's it. That's my late August so far. I am loving it. It's super fun to work on. This yarn is very sheddy, which is hard for me and my sinuses. I'm super sensitive. I'm a super wimp when it comes to sheddy yarns where it flies around and gets in your eyes and nose and I feel like I'm breathing the fibers in. So that's been a little, it gets to me sometimes, but mostly I'm okay. What I need to do is get like a surgical mask, just one of those like flimsy paper ones to wear while I work on it, which is like super weird, but I think that might help. So late August is a pie shawl by Sylvia McFadden. You should totally check it out if you're interested. The yarn is Sincere Sheep in the Gleam base. And I am knitting this on my size 8s. Knit Picks interchangeables, wooden needles. And I did just switch to the bigger cord. I have these on like a I think like a 24-inch cord before I got to the last increase round. And then after the last increase round, I switched to a 32-inch, I think. And in case you're interested, the way that I switch needle cord sizes when I go up to a bigger cord is I will take off, for interchangeables, I'll take off the needles from the cords that the project is already on, and I'll put on smaller needles, and then take the whole brand new cord, put the needles I need on that cord, and then just start knitting with the new cord and needle set. It's a really easy way to do it in case you ever have to do that. So there she is. That's been super fun. I love pie shawls a lot. That's all the knitting I've been doing. I have some spinning to share. I finally picked back up on my project for my Helen Stewart shawl. So this is my entry into Kristen of Yarngasm's Curious Handmade Cal. In her group, she is doing a knit along for any Curious Handmade pattern, which is Helen Stewart. And I am doing the Sonder shawl, but first I am spinning the yarn for it. I started this spinning project a while ago and then dropped it because I have a short attention span. And with the coming of this knit along, I decided to pick it back up again. And this is what I have so far. So this is two fleeces that I had that I got blended together and processed into roving. Pin drafted roving is what it's called. The person who did the processing for me is Sherry of Moro Fleece Works, and she is amazing. If you have a fleece that you need processed into roving, send it to her. She is amazing and she does beautiful work. I'll link to her in the show notes. So I had an alpaca fleece from a coworker's sister-in-law's alpaca, and a fleece from a sheep fleece. I don't know what breed it was, but it was a fleece that somebody didn't want, so they gave it to my local yarn shop, and my local yarn shop gave it to me. So I had both of those fleeces, which were both this beautiful chocolate brown color, blended into, I got like many pounds of roving from this. So I have a ton of this stuff, and it's all in these beautiful beehive roving sets. Anyway, so I've started spinning this fiber long draw, which is a woolen style spinning technique, and I love it so much. I hardly ever do long draw because for me it takes a certain, the fiber has to be exactly prepped exactly right to make it easy to long draw spin because I'm not that good at it. So if a fiber wants to do it, I'm all over it. But if it fights me at all, I won't do it. This fiber is super easy to spin long draw. I think it's a combination of the fiber and just of the prep, this pin drafted roving that Sherry does. It's really easy to do it from. So I'm trying to do pretty thick singles because I'm in the end going for a bulky weight yarn, and I'm not sure if I'm going to get that yet doing a 2-ply or a 3-ply. So I'm going to spin a second bobbin, this is my first bobbin, and kind of see what it looks like together, and I think I might need to do a third bobbin to make it a 3-ply. And long draw spinning creates the most beautiful yarn. I can't wait. It's, look at this. Okay, so these are my singles. And then check out this. It's super, super squishy. Usually I would not be able to squish it like this if it were a worsted spun or short draw single. So it's super airy, super fluffy, and it's still got lanolin in it a little bit. And so it's just, it feels really, really great. I've got a lot of this fiber. This is some of it. And this is pretty much what I've been spinning off of. I'm going to do two more bobbins and see where that goes. And then I'm going to knit the Sonder shawl, which was a shawl from Helen Stewart's Shawl Society Club from last year. And it's a bulky weight shawl. It's beautiful. It's an elongated triangle. It's kind of scarfy rather than shawly. And I love that. It's got tassels. I can't wait. So that's been super fun. My next spinning project I'm really, really excited about. I have still been keeping up on my spindling, and this is where I'm at now. So this is the same thing of fiber that I had last week when I showed you. I've just been adding to it, and it's been so much fun. I've really, really been enjoying it, which is so cool because I never used to enjoy drop spindling. And like I said before, Casey from the Creative Musings podcast was drop spindling, and I was inspired to pull this thing out, which I haven't used in ages. And it's been really fun. I was super surprised that I actually, like, I'm enjoying it now more than I ever have before. And I have been using these Rolags, which is my first time using Rolags. I've had these Rolags for a long time, and I tried wheel spinning with some of them, and I wasn't really able to do it, so I'd never used them after that. But drop spindling with them is so easy and so fun, and oh my god, I'm loving it. So the first one I used was a Ren and Ollie Rolag, and that was sent with an order a long time ago as like a sample. And then I have this whole other set of Rolags that I actually won in a giveaway a long time ago. And I'm so excited to actually be using them now. They're so fun. So I'm gonna show you, and I'm sorry for the crinkling, but it's just gonna crinkle. There's a lot of crinkling in this. So this is what I've got. It's a set of Rolags from the Woolly Witch, and I will link to her shop, her Etsy shop, in the show notes. And it's this set of Rolags. They're all different colors and all different fiber blends as well. And oh my god, I've been loving these so hard. These have been so fun to use. So the one that I'm working on right now is this one, which are totally my colors. This thing is just so freaking beautiful. I love it so much. And I think this one is alpaca and merino. And oh, I just love it. It's spinning up pretty marled white and brown and gray. And I love it. And underneath here, you can't see it anymore, but the last Rolag I used was like purple and blue and pink. And then before that was the very first one I used that I showed you last week, which I kind of can't remember what it looks like now, but watch last week's episode. You'll see what it looks like. That was the Ren and Ollie one. And I'm just super excited about spinning from Rolags on a drop spindle. Like I said a couple minutes ago, spinning from Rolags onto a wheel, for some reason, was too hard for me when I first tried it, and it did not work. But on a drop spindle, for whatever reason, they spin beautifully, and I really, really love doing it. And that has been super fun. So my plan for this is my entry right now into the mini scrap along, because I'm using these little mini things of fiber. And I have just been spinning them one after another onto my spindle and just, you know, connecting them as I switch. I think I'm gonna keep them as singles. And then when I'm done and I have enough on here and I wanna take it off, I'm gonna skein it up, wash it, keep it as a single, and add it to my granny stripe crochet blanket. So it's just gonna be one long single of a whole bunch of different Rolags, different fibers, different colors. There's a woodpecker on my apple tree right now. I'm sorry. But I sit in my office in front of a sliding glass window. It's right in front of me, and right outside my window are my two giant old apple trees. They're like 50 years old, and they're big and they're beautiful and they're flowering right now, which is awesome. And a woodpecker just landed on one of them, and he's super cute, so I'm watching him. Anyway, so this is going to go into my granny stripe crochet blanket, And I'm really excited about it. I've really been into spinning singles lately, and I think this is going to be super cool. So, yay for drop spindles and Rolex. I love it. I'm loving this right now. It's so funny because drop spindling for me a long time ago was really difficult and like really not fun. And then I've been wheel spinning for a long time and that's super fun too. But now going back to this, it's just been great. I'm really, really happy that I'm like liking this now. So that's cool. And that's all the spinning I've been doing, which is really good because I've been in kind of a spinning funk the past couple months. And it's really nice to be able to pick this stuff up again and get some things made. I did do a little bit of sewing last weekend, which was a little bit of a process. I talked last week about the Agnes top, which is a Tilly and the Buttons pattern. I wore my Agnes top last week and it is my favorite thing that I've ever sewn. I love it. It fits so well and I love it. So I wanted to make the Agnes dress. This is a pattern hack that you can find on the Tilly and the Buttons blog and I will link to that in the show notes. It's a way to make the Agnes top into a dress and I did that. I did that this last weekend. It was not without its issues, but here it is. So this is my Agnes dress. It has a gathered skirt, which was my first time doing gathers. And it's this scoop neck top. I did the quarter length sleeve version. There's also a long sleeve version. And it's out of this really cute kind of tealish, teal and pink pattern with flowers on it. I like it. So I sewed the second to the smallest size for the top, for the Agnes top. Every time I've made it, I've made two Agnes tops and this is my third time doing it. And I think I need to switch to the smallest size because this was too big, which is really weird because the first time I sewed it was my bat, my top with bats on it that I wore last week, and it fits perfectly. And that was the second to the smallest size. And then I made this and I used that same size and it was way too big. This is super janky because I sewed it, it was way too big. I attached the skirt. I looked like a little kid wearing it. It was huge and it fit weird and it didn't look good. So I pretty much just went in and took in the side seams all the way down from the tip of the sleeves all the way down to the bottom of the skirt, which is totally not what you're supposed to do, but oh well, that's what I did. And I took it in a lot, which made the sleeves and the top fit pretty weird because it's not what you're supposed to do. But that's what I did. And I think next time I am going to sew the Agnes top again. I don't know if I'll sew the dress again. But the next time I sew the top, I'm going to go down to the smallest size. And I think that'll be better because the second Agnes top that I made was also a little big. So I don't know what happened. I don't know what's going on. But I think I need to switch to the smaller size. So I did take in the side seams a lot. I've never done a gathered skirt before, like I said, and I don't know if it's my favorite. I feel like it looks weird on my waist, at least in dress form. Maybe in skirt form it's better, but sitting on my waist as a dress, the gathers, I feel like look a little kiddish, and that's probably me because I'm a pretty small person, I'm pretty short, and I sometimes feel like I can look like a little kid. but I feel like this really accentuates that. So I do like how the dress came out, but I don't know if I'll make it again. I would like to make more jersey dresses like this in this same general shape, but not with the gathers. So it fits pretty well. It's a little wonky. Like I said, I had to take it in a lot, so that messed with the shoulder fit, kind of. It's a little deep. The scoop neck's a little low for my taste, which is weird because the first one I made wasn't too low and it was perfect. I don't know. But the scoop neck on this one is a little low. Also, the band here is a little wonky. It puckers out a little bit, so I feel like I should have made it shorter so that it brought it in a little bit rather than having extra fabric to gape out. So I learned a lot of, I always learn things when I sew things because I'm still a super beginner sewer, sewist. And yes, it's wearable, but I won't be wearing it to work. But it's super cute. It's shorter than I would like. I put it on and I showed it to my husband and I was like, yeah, this is it. It didn't really come out that great, but it's wearable. And he was like, what are you talking about? You're crazy. I love it. I think it's his favorite thing that I've ever sewn. He loves how it looks on me. So that's cool. Probably, I think we're all a little more critical of the things that we make than maybe other people are. So he thinks it looks really good. And I will wear it. I'll probably wear it with leggings underneath. And yeah, it's, like I said, it's short. It comes up a few inches above the knee, which my personal taste, I like wearing things that hit just at the knee or maybe even a little below the knee. So it's a little short for me. He thinks it looks great though. He thinks I need to wear more shorter skirts. And I could have made it whatever length I wanted. That's just what I ended up cutting. So anyway, this is the Agnes top hacked into a dress. And it's made out of jersey cotton. I sew all of my jersey knits, all of my jersey clothes that I sew on a regular sewing machine. I've got a Janome. I don't have a serger. And to do that, it's pretty simple. You just use a zigzag stitch for all your seams. And yeah, so this is the first garment I've sewn in a little while. It's, like I said, it's not perfect, but it definitely made me want to sew more. I'm out of jersey fabric now, though, which I love using, so I think I might be buying more of that soon. We'll see. Yay! I really do love the fabric, the print on this. It's super pretty. The color is a little bright, but I like it. So I will be wearing that soon around the house at first, and then we'll see if I go out in it. That's all for everything that I've made this week. I do have an Ask Me Anything question to answer. I've got an AMA thread in the Ravelry group. And I got a question that was asked by Opsti, who is Anna from Germany. And Anna has been a supporter of the podcast from the very, very beginning. So, hi, Anna. Thank you so much for asking a question. I am going to answer it now. And this question was about this little fox painting that I've got in the background. So she asked where it came from and if she can get one. And thank you for asking, Anna. I am gonna go grab it and I'll show you guys a little better view of it. So I just have it tacked up on my wall, but this is it. And I love this painting so much. I got this in a swap. I have done a lot of swaps, fiber swaps, and I love swapping. I just freaking love it. I love getting mail. I love sending mail. I love putting together packages. So this was a swap that I did through the Tiny Owl Knits group on Ravelry, which is a really, really great group for swaps. They do a lot of swaps in that group. And if you're interested in swapping, check out that group because their swaps are really awesome. They do really big, elaborate ones, and they do really small ones down to just like card swaps. So I did a swap in that group a long time ago with, I'm sorry if I pronounce this wrong, because I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it, but I'm going to guess, Aislinn Silverwolf, who is Misha? And she was my swap partner a long time ago. She sent me an amazing package, which included this painting that she did herself and gave to me as a gift. And I love it so much. It's been hanging on my wall ever since. She does not have a shop, but I messaged her on Ravelry and asked about her paintings. And she said that if anybody's interested in getting a painting or a print from her, you're welcome to message her on Ravelry and see if she can do a commission for you. So if you're interested, I will link to her Ravelry name in the show notes and I'll put it here on the screen. Message her and tell her what you want and see if it's something she can do. I love this painting so much. I am not a visual artist, so I'm not quite sure what it's made out of, but I think it might be pen and what are they called? Like pastels, like chalk pastels with water or watercolor maybe? I don't know. But it's beautiful and I love it. I love animals and I love foxes. And I just love it. I love the way she put it together too on this like natural paper with the washi tape. I love it. So that's the origin story of my little fox painting. Aislinn Silverwolf made this for me a long time ago and I love it. So thank you for asking, Anna. If you have any questions that you would like me to answer either on the podcast or in the group, check out that Ask Me Anything thread and add it in there and I'll see what I can do about getting you an answer. As for favorites, I didn't prepare anything to talk about this week, but off the top of my head, I can think of a couple things that I think are cool. I didn't know about this until last night. My husband and I were doing dishes, and for some reason, he thought to tell me about it. Apparently, Nintendo has put out a reissue of the Super Nintendo Entertainment System in mini form and preloaded with original Nintendo games. Now, that could all be totally wrong. I have not looked it up at all. I'm just going based on what my husband told me, so if I'm wrong, it's his fault. If I'm giving you misinformation, let's blame Colin, my husband. But I thought that was so effing cool. I love Nintendo. I love Super Nintendo. I mentioned this a long time ago on one of the early episodes of the podcast. I am a wannabe gamer so hard. I love video games, but I'm so bad at them. And it's not only that I'm bad at them, I think they're boring. I know it's stupid. Why do I want to do it if I think it's boring? I wish I didn't think it was boring because I don't think it's boring for the first 10 minutes. And then after like 10 minutes of playing a video game, I'm like, ugh, I can't do this anymore. Because I'm so bad at it and I just keep losing and dying all the time that I'm not into them, but I wish I was into them. And the ones that I am into are all Super Nintendo and regular Nintendo games. I loved Nintendo games. They were the only games that could ever hold my interest in the whole entire world. So Nintendo put out this Super Nintendo system where it's like, apparently, it looks the way the original Super Nintendo looked, only it's smaller. And it's all preloaded with those old games. And I think that's... and it like hooks up to modern TVs like, or something. And I think that's super exciting and I really want one. And he told me that they released it and made so many of them. And they were super popular and sold out really quick. And then they stopped making them. So he says that he thinks there's like one more batch that's coming out that can be purchased. I don't think I'm going to, but I'm still really excited about the idea of it. I think it's really cool. To me, it proves that those original SNES games were like the best video games of all time. The fact that they're coming out again and they were so popular, I think that's super neat. I really love Super Nintendo a lot. Yeah. And the other thing, is a musician that I pretty recently discovered and was listening to just before I started recording when I was setting up for the podcast. I was listening to her album. This is Angel Olsen, and I don't know really anything about her. I found her on YouTube. I do that thing where I watch music videos on YouTube, and then I go through the rabbit hole of the recommended videos, and I just I found her that way. Watching videos from another band that I super duper love called Power Bottom. Don't Google that. Do not Google Power Bottom. If you're interested in a queer glam rock band, I will link to them in the show notes. I love them. I don't know if you will, but I do. And I was watching their videos. They make really good music videos. The production value on their music videos is like so good. So I was watching all of their videos, and then in the sidebar, I got distracted by Angel Olsen, and I fell in love with her music. So I got one of her albums called My Woman, and the song that hooked me onto her was, it's called Shut Up, Kiss Me, Hold Me Tight, and it's so good. It's really good. I recommend checking out Angel Olsen if you're interested in, I don't know what genre she is. Because like I said, I only know her from accidentally discovering her on YouTube. I would call it maybe, I guess it's rock and roll. Girl rock and roll. Think of like, maybe the Pixies meets Julie Cruz. You might know who the Pixies are because they're super famous. Julie Cruz is less famous, so you might not know who she is. She did the soundtrack for Twin Peaks, which is one of the best shows of all time, in my opinion. Really ethereal, kind of spacey female vocalist. Anyway, Angel Olsen. I'll link to her in the show notes if you're interested in checking her out. That song and video, Shut Up, Kiss Me, and Hold Me Tight, is just so good. I love it. And it's stuck in my head all the time. So those are the two things that popped into my head that I'm excited about right now. And that is all I have to share with you this week. Still in the works on setting up Moonstone Dye Works. So stay tuned for that. Things are getting really, really close to being able to launch. And I'm going to keep you up to date on the podcast and on Instagram. So thank you again for everybody who's been supporting that endeavor. And if you liked the video this week, please give it a thumbs up here or here, wherever it is, and subscribe to the channel if you want to be kept up to date on future episodes. Join the Ravelry group, join the make-along, the mini scrap-along, and I will see you guys next week. Have fun, stay awesome. Bye, guys.